So, hi everyone. My name is Jessica Dill, and I work in the research department at the Federal Reserve Bank of Atlanta. I'm also past president of the Atlanta Economics Club, which is a local chapter of a national organization called the National Association for Business Economics. And so, through the Atlanta Economics Club and the National Association for Business Economics, or NABE, we are very interested in building the pipeline of future economics professionals. And because of that, we have created a partnership with local student econ clubs, including Georgia Tech, Oglethorpe University, and Georgia Gwinnett College's econ club. And we formed what we call ECOI, or that's what I call it, but that stands for the Econ Collaborative of Atlanta Area Academic Institutions. And so the goal is to pull together students from all of the Atlanta area institutions, whether you're an econ major or not, and talk about all the really cool things that you can do with an econ degree. So without further ado, tonight we're here to explore the intersection of economics and entrepreneurship, and we have a really wonderful panel to speak with you today, a panel of entrepreneurs, and it will be moderated by Bernie. So Bernie, I'll hand it over to you to take away the conversation.
Thank you. Good evening, everyone. And just sort of logistically, how we do this is meant to be as interactive as possible. So if anybody on the call has a comment or a question, raise your hand and we'll take it there or put it in the chat box. Jessica will check on that and just feel free to interrupt me when you see something that comes from the audience. So again, we're here to answer your questions more than anything else. We're not here to give presentations. And you have the bios of the panelists, and they'll have an opportunity to tell a little more about this as we go through this more or less an hour that we have for this. But just to keep in mind, for one, all three panelists here, except for me, I am not an entrepreneur. They are all entrepreneurs. I help entrepreneurs. So that's sort of the overall theme, if you want, to put them sort of into buckets, and I mean this in the best way, not silos, maybe more like flower pots out of which they grew. Andrew is by education, he has a background in economics. Lavi has a background in, and I pick a few because all of them have very different backgrounds, not just one economics or another, like environmental engineering from Lavi. He could talk to you about quite a few things that go back to your education. And Jade's background is educationally is in education. But they all found their different ways to get here. And maybe to get things started. And by the way, panelists too, chime in as we have this conversation. I'm not going off a script with a bunch of questions we need to all cover. As you see interesting strings, path develop here that you'd like to comment on or continue, please interrupt or raise your hand so that I don't miss something here that's interesting. Maybe Andrew, we start with you. If you could just tell us very short up front, so what's your origin to get to this? How did you get to where you are today?
Wow. And just answer it quickly. How did you get to where you are today? So Bernie, so what I do today, you'd say, well, an economics degree helped prepare you for that. So what I do today is I am an entrepreneur in the events space. So, and particularly in financial technology and blockchain. So I help curate content, events, build communities in that space. So when I was thinking about going to college and what I would major in, I had this, so I graduated from high school in 85 and from undergrad in 89. And as a teenager, I was a hobbyist with computers. Personal computers were new, right? It was a new phenomenon, and I had gotten a computer and taught myself how to program it and so forth. So I went off to college and had a started with a computer science major. But I was like, I don't think I want to do that for a living, but I have this talent. And so let me start there and let me figure out what else I want to major in. And my parents were not business people or entrepreneurs. My mom was a school teacher and my father was a minister and a social worker. So they didn't know anything about business. So therefore I didn't know very much either, but I thought that I wanted to be a banker. And I don't know that I knew what a banker did, but I think I wanted to be a banker. But instead of majoring in finance, mostly because I didn't understand the difference between finance and economics, I decided to be an economics major. And we'll come back to it later. I don't want to take too much time with this, but what I discovered about economics that was really interesting that I didn't realize is that the difference is that it's a social science and that it's about people and about their decisions and how different forces impact their lives. And it related more to my mom's teacher role and my dad's pastor role than I thought, even though I was going into business because it was about people. But I can, Bernie, tell them a little bit more how I got from college to becoming an events entrepreneur, but that's how it started, is wanting to be a banker and choosing economics as a way to get there.
Yeah, I'm taking notes here. It's a lot to come back to, but I want to give everybody with an opportunity to start things out. Love that, thanks. Lavinia, may get to you. Maybe more specifically, how did you get to your business idea?
So see, I had two business ideas. Both are within the tennis space. I played quite a bit of tennis. I coached Jessica for a while. so yeah, I mean, it just started with a passion for tennis, right? I had sound advice from someone who said, do what you have a passion for, and that was tennis. I started with a racket sensor company. So before all this kind of computer vision came about, we took a little device, put a bunch of sensors in it, stuck in a racket, and it tracked your speed of the racket, it tracked the spin, all that type of stuff, and it was recorded into your phone, and then you get these cool insights, right? So That was my first kind of invention or entrepreneurship ride. We raised some money there. It was a great run. Learned a lot. We learned that hardware was hard. So you wanted to get to something a bit less complex for the next go around. And this time, it's still about tennis, but this time it's more of a, I guess, less tech and more e-commerce, where we sell tennis gear to passionate tennis players. But again, it just starts with a passion. I would say passion is more important than skill set, because you can learn a skill set, but having a passion for something, having that continued motivation, that's the challenge. So that's what I would like to stress.
And you came out of, I mean, you had different variants of engineering, right? And environmental, for example, environmental engineering, but that didn't play, it seems, like a particular role in your choice. You had more skills about the engineering aspects of building the product you wanted to have?
Yeah, so I did computer and electrical engineering, and I can safely say that I didn't use any of it in practice, like in actual corporations or anything like that, but it did give me a nice analytical skill set to understand how to use data, to understand just numbers in general. And that is something that's key, I think. Economics also has that same kind of that feel, right? You need to understand numbers to make it work. And I think that's key. I think that's something that has really helped, just from things like the unit economics of selling a product online to creating, you know, larger P&Ls for a tech company, things like that. So the economics is also a foundation that I didn't learn, you know, like at school as much, but it definitely is something that was needed.
So over to you, Jay. You studied education, and just on the face of it, there seems to be a pretty big leap from that to becoming an entrepreneur. What got you there?
Yes. So I do want to specify as well that while I was an entrepreneur at Spelman College, my alma mater, I'm actually similarly to Bernie, working at a startup accelerator where I support entrepreneurs. And so the tie-in there is that I am able to help a lot of students through entrepreneurial education. And so there's a direct tie-in there with my background as an entrepreneur and now being able to help other students in their pursuit of entrepreneurship. But I will share a little bit about my background and journey into entrepreneurship, and hopefully this is helpful to a lot of the students that are on the call. Spelman had what was called the 10-day Spellpreneur pitch program. And that program was actually a competition very similar to a hackathon. So I knew that I really, had an entrepreneurial mindset and I wanted to get started, but I wasn't sure which idea I wanted to start off with. And so by entering a hackathon, it was a very fast-paced way to launch a business. And my team actually placed first. We got our first initial capital for our idea as well. And so all of a sudden we were in the heart of the Georgia startup entrepreneurial ecosystem. And that journey was really exciting. I was able to learn quickly just about how interconnected, especially the Atlanta entrepreneurship ecosystem is. Everybody knows each other and everybody is really supportive. And so when our startup decided to dissemble, I knew that I really loved the ecosystem. And so I wanted to explore a way to continue to support entrepreneurs and to work with entrepreneurs without having to be an entrepreneur myself. And so I was excited to be invited by NextCubed, which is a startup accelerator based in the Bay Area, to come in and launch a nonprofit called the HBCU Founders Initiative. And so through this initiative, we're able to provide funding, resources, programs, events, mentorship, et cetera, for students and alumni of HBCUs. And this has been a really great opportunity to be able to support founders and provide all the resources without having to be an entrepreneur myself.
Interesting, because what that just triggered in my mind, maybe I'll ask LaVie about this, because you pretty much jumped from your educational upfront piece of your life education into an entrepreneur, and you build a product. In hindsight, do you think that was the best path to go? Or would it more sense for someone coming out of school to have a job first, work in some companies, get some work experience, and then build their own business?
So, Bernie, for me?
Yeah.
So I did my first job out of school. I was a consultant for Accenture. So they're as big as big can be. Like they're just global. I worked with really cool clients across the board that ranged from a bank in Canada to Disney, right? You get a vast array of just experience. And not only that, it's different companies and industries, but also different functions. So I was a product manager for one. I was an energy trader, pseudo really bad energy trader, but that was one thing I did. It helped me understand what I did and did not like. And that helped me kind of understand that I like to travel. I traveled a lot there. I like meeting new people. I didn't like some of the work, some of the functions I did. And that helped kind of propel me to understand really what I should go after. So I think that was a really good finding. And also to Jay's point, one thing about the ecosystem and community, I spent time in the Atlanta kind of startup world too, and it's 100% is a community and everyone does know each other. So it's a very big kind of pay it forward mentality.
Yeah. Andrew, what about you? Because you had a corporate life before you started the company.
Well, I know. I was thinking about this part because, going back to kind of my journey, it was a job, a corporate job, that caused me to want to be an entrepreneur, right? And this is how that happened. So I was in college. You remember I wanted to be a banker, but I had this computer science economics double major. And while I was in college, I did an internship at IBM as a programmer, big corporate at IBM. And they made me a job offer based on that internship. And it was so much more money than some of the bank management training programs. I decided to take that job. At the time, IBM was famous for something called lifetime employment. No one ever got fired from IBM. You could go to IBM, as long as you perform, you could work there until retirement, right? But remember that PC that I bought? Well, IBM didn't quite get the memo on the PC. And the time that I was IBM, their stock went from $170 a share to $40 a share. And it was the end of lifetime employment at IBM. And I saw people young with young families, my managers lose their jobs, and they thought they would be taken care of forever, but they weren't, right? So it was fine for me because I was young. So I went off to got my MBA and moved on. But it was that experience that helped me understand that you really have to be an entrepreneur, whether you're in a job or whether you're starting a business. And I started to view jobs and employers as clients. And they're not there to take care of me. They're there. It's an opportunity. I've got this. I can do this work and they'll pay me for that. And I can still be a part of growing that business that I work for and be proud of it. But they're not there to take care of me forever. That's my job, to take care of myself forever. And so I started to think more about considering entrepreneurial opportunities, or even when I took a job, thinking like an entrepreneur in that job.
Yeah. Great. So Jade, if I see sort of your progress properly, you didn't have much of a corporate life, if you want to call it that, before you started a company.
Right. So this is my.
Did you miss something?
So this is my first role post-grad. So I guess technically is corporate, but it feels pretty fun getting to work with entrepreneurs. And I would consider myself an intrapreneur as well, because doing a lot of program development and organization, I've had a lot of the freedom to be able to initiate and implement my own ideas, but under the umbrella of a corporate. And I would definitely give that advice to students, if you're curious about making the leap, but not really, ready, if you're or not sure if you want to, go full corporate or not, maybe look for roles where you can be able to implement ideas and be able to execute and do project development within a company.
So what do you think, since you are both an entrepreneur, but you're also helping entrepreneurs, what do you think an accelerator in that sense brings to entrepreneurs? What do you get out of it the most?
Absolutely. I really love to encourage entrepreneurs to do accelerators. And so really curious, Andrew and Libby, if you guys have had experiences in them, because accelerators are a really cool opportunity to be able to go to school for your business. And it's a really great way to be able to learn different skills to apply to your business and to be able to ask questions, make connections, have specific business mentors, et cetera. So it's a great way to apply school concepts, but specifically to your business. So I think it's a great way to also make sure that you have a safety net in place, by really being encouraged to do customer discovery and to ask questions and to make sure you understand your customer before you go build, before you go put money into your business. Accelerators will teach you those skills and encourage you. And so I think they are really, really great opportunities and programs.
Yeah. Everyone?
Yeah, I can add to that. Then the first startup, the hardware startup, we joined Hacks. So Hackcelerator, Hackcelerator. And it was extremely eye-opening. The first thing, we moved to Shenzhen, China, me and my founder, and we pretty much lived in the office with 10 other founders, doing things from having a hydroponic system to grow plants, to a tennis sensor, to a cigarette lighter that prevented people from smoking. So all sorts of wild ideas, right? And it was cool just being near like-minded people, and it's 100% motivating. You present to each other and you critique each other. And they have a pretty good set of mentors, from very, very big brands, from IDEO to McKinsey to just everywhere. So they help bring that. And you do give a piece of equity most of the time. Some work have different new revenue streams, stuff like that, but at the end of the day, it was well worth it. I think the connections you make, the friends you make, things like that. So
what was the, in hindsight, what was the most valuable thing, if you want, that you got out of your time in an accelerator?
I mean, two things. I mean, the network coming out of it was great, but honestly, it was just fun. Like, it was just, there's no other time in my life where I could say that I, you know, did so many new things I'd never done with so many different people. Like, literally, it was, you were in China, we were American, there were two other American companies, one from Spain, one from Poland, three from China, and literally, it's just a giant melting pot of people trying to build cool things.
That sounds great.
Yeah.
Andrew, any of your experience in that?
Well, yeah. So one of the projects I've worked on over the past few months is launching something in Atlanta called the Atlanta Blockchain Center. And this has been really fun for me because rather than being a conference that happens once a year, which is typically what I would do, it's an ongoing community. And it's I think you'd describe it more as an incubator than an accelerator, but same idea, right? It is co-working spaces for entrepreneurs who are working on interesting projects using blockchain tech. Some of it's in the financial world, some of it's with NFTs or the metaverse, all these exciting projects. And they have the opportunity to come to a single space like Lavi was describing and share from each other. There are mentors associated with the program. They have access to funding for their projects through our, you know, network of investors at the center. And I've played the role of helping to build this community and build the Atlanta Blockchain Center. And what you see is you learn from the mentors, but they also learn from each other. And that support system is really important for entrepreneurs.
Good to hear.
And I would encourage, if there's anyone out there interested in blockchain, to check that out, right? It's a physical space in Buckhead. There are events every week. It's free to be a part of it. There's a lot of resources in Atlanta, and that's certainly one of them. Yeah.
Jessica, just breaking here real quick. Do you have any questions from the audience?
Yes, they're rolling in. The first question that we received is, what are some skills and knowledge that can help someone move through the process, starting with ideation to actually kind of getting to that launch point? Like, how do you know if you don't go to an accelerator, how do you know you're ready? How do you navigate that?
Lavi, you want to start with that? You just froze. Maybe Jade, do you have, I'll just throw this question to you.
Absolutely. I'll jump in and I hope that I'm addressing the question correctly. But I think a good way to be able to, you know, explore entrepreneurship without diving in, one is joining a hackathon. I really have loved participating in hackathons. You know, whether there's tons, you know, there's usually some at your local institution, but also just in the community, lots of corporates throw hackathons as a way to just really build teams and help, you know, everybody to build ideas. So I would say that's always a good way to kind of get your feet wet without having to fully dive in. And there's tons of resources now. So even on Twitter, there's lots of great knowledge that's being exchanged as far as entrepreneurship. There's great books, there's great podcasts. As well. So you can really talk to other entrepreneurs and listen to their stories and see if that might be something that you're interested in. So I hope I addressed the question right and happy to elaborate if not.
Andrew, any comments from your side on the question?
Yeah, so the question is more about how do I know, because could you, what's your understanding of the question, Bernie? Because I'm not sure that I followed. I know that one thought that came to mind though was, just for entrepreneurship generally, going to work for an early stage startup and learning from that. You learn an awful lot by observing the founders and the leadership of that company. My first job, right, in this space that I do work now in events was to be the head of content for a big conference called Money 2020. And there was two entrepreneurs that started that conference. And I learned so much from watching how they worked that now I'm able to do what they did on my own, right? And put my own stamp on it and do it in a different, slightly different way. But I think sometimes, you know, being around founders and maybe even working at startups can kind of give you the, and it also helps you build a network of, hey, and if you, a founder will be very loyal to you if you help them be successful in building their company, and they'll want to help you later on in your career. Yeah.
Any other questions, Jessica?
Yes. So we have a question about advice. So what advice do you have for someone who doesn't really know, they don't have an idea of what they want to start or do with the business, but they don't want to work in corporate and they kind of want to maybe consider entrepreneurship. Do you have any advice?
Maybe you shoot this over to Lavi because you're back live.
Yeah. I think starting with your passion. So I'll give you an example. One time I started the company because I thought I could make a decent buck. You'll probably laugh at this idea, but we were looking to build a pet supply company selling dog mats to Japan. Nuts, right? Yeah, there was a big gap in that market. The Japanese culture, they love dogs, and it gets hot, and this mat would help cool their dogs. And there was a big demand for it, particularly on Amazon. So I went into that and, you know, invested a few $1,000s, and I quickly learned that there was a lot of lost in translation with, like, literally and figuratively with the Japanese language. So that taught me a lot, and it wasn't motivating and it wasn't fun, to be honest. So that's why I kind of stuck to tennis, because at the end of the day, you want to be having fun doing what you do. You make money, that's great. If you make a lot of money, that's even better. You help a lot of people out, that's even better. But start with what you enjoy, start with what you care about.
Yeah. Jade, can I throw that over to you relative to this passion piece? Because I've been in conversations like this with students quite a few times. And as soon as you bring out passion, purpose, values, the world gets all of a sudden very, very mushy for students. I think they expect passion to be this big thing about this immigration issue that I need to resolve, or climate change that I need to resolve. But it doesn't have to be a big thing like this, right? Can you tell us a little bit what that means to you?
Absolutely. So, Kim, I would definitely encourage you, if you don't know which idea you have, and you might have, as Bernie just said, all of these large scale ideas and you don't know where to get started, maybe start with an everyday small problem. You can, you know, always interview your family and friends and just learn about their day-to-day lives and ask them, you know, what would make your life easier? And through questions like that, you know, you can really be able to start to find what problem you're passionate about. I think when entrepreneurs have an issue that they're really passionate about solving, you know, then it aligns with them being passionate about helping that customer base, and that can help them to be able to, you know, excel with an idea. I also left a fellowship in the chat. You might want to explore that. There's a entrepreneurship fellowship where you can really be able to explore entrepreneurship. And I would encourage you to explore other fellowships as well. That might be a happy medium of not diving into the corporate world, but starting to explore entrepreneurship as well. And then I might have been answering your question with the last answer, but hackathons. You know, you can always join another student startup team that is working on solving a challenge, and that way you can also get exposure. I love that Andrew said join an early stage startup as well, because you're going to get a lot of exposure there too. So just diving in, getting started, you know, attending events in Atlanta, just really, you know, once you start to get involved, you'll start to find your way there.
So Andrew,
the brain is I was just going to say, there's an interesting story. There's a company I think everyone would know called Square. I think they've changed the company name to Block, but it's the little devices that accept your credit cards, right? And there's a story about how that company was started. One of the co-founders was a glass blower. He was an artist, and he just wanted to sell his art, but it was difficult to sell the art because he couldn't, you know, accept credit cards, right? So there's a lot, so many stories like that of a problem in the course of someone's life that they recognize is a problem, and they decide, you know, I'm going to build, you know, a company, I'm going to solve that problem, and it turns into the solution to the problem can become an entrepreneurial opportunity. So it's almost like being an author, where you take notes and observe the world and keep a little record of ideas that you can bring into a book. It's the same kind of mindset to be an entrepreneur. You're living your life and there's something that personally frustrates you that you think, you know, could be solved. And then you start looking for the solution. And sometimes there's an idea there that you could build a company around.
So when you seek that path to become an entrepreneur, are your options relative to the passion that you want to address, to follow, are you limited there by the skills you have and you need to build on that? Or you just follow the passion and you learn what it takes to succeed with it? Andrew, just wanted to follow up with you.
Oh, well, I can. That's why a lot of companies have co-founders. because, so the big conference that I worked for, there were two very different individuals that co-founded that conference. One was very good at marketing, was very creative, but they weren't all that disciplined, and the other was very disciplined and, you know, got things done and very intense. And they complemented one another quite well. So I think you need to have some self-awareness of what you're good at and, you know, what are your strengths, and to make the most of those. And you can always develop, and a weakness can become a strength. But you also need to find a team of people and partners that can fill in the gaps that you might have in building a company.
Yeah. Ravi, yes. Go
We're
ahead.
Getting more questions, and I don't know if you're keeping an eye or if I needed to interject, but I...
No, it's good.
Okay, there's one that came in before Andrew, but I want to build on the question and also pitch it to Andrew and to Lavi. So the question, Andrew, is, in working for IBM, was the first few years really challenging, and did you make a lot of connections working through IBM? And I would flip the same question afterwards to Lavi about Accenture and your connections there, just with the big corporation. So go ahead, Andrew.
Yeah, so IBM was great. You know, I'd worked there while I was in college. And so it was made the transition easier because I was working with some of the same people that, you know, I'd done with my internship. And I didn't necessarily expand my network a great deal through that first job, but I learned a lot about, you know, I had an internal customer that I had to understand their requirements and then deliver, you know, code and programming that would meet those requirements. And I just kind of learned about how to serve a client, even though it was an internal client inside the company. I learned about how to work in a team. You know, I just had a lot of learning from that experience. And then, as I mentioned before, the big learning was just, you know, that corporate America can sometimes be unforgiving and that, you know, it's not just like my economics professor always said, there's no such thing as a free lunch, right? So it's like you're going to have to create your own path. And I learned a lot from that.
Yeah, I mean, I would say some of the more valuable things I learned from Accenture that might be not too obvious sometimes. I mean, coming out of school, I was pretty naive, I think, just me personally. I didn't know, just even writing the right type of emails to the right person, who to CC, things like that. Those politics are, you know, you have to kind of experience it, in my opinion. And that helped to do that during that corporate world. And that definitely helps with any entrepreneurial role. How to build relationships too, I think is the big one. One book, I think it was a question about books. I think it was how to influence or win friends and influence people. And that one's like one of the best books ever. And it's just like a psychology book, but it's, the title is a little strange, but I think the principles are very strong. So I would say that. One thing I want to say about the skill set question, that one before, I built a tech company that did data analysis of racket swings. I know zero about data science at all. I know nothing, absolutely nothing about it. And I didn't think I learned that much afterwards. I say that to say that, like, you can find very talented people everywhere, all over the world. And if you're a person who can help share an idea, share a passion, get people excited, that's probably one of the key things you can do. Because if you can convince people to help you, and obviously they get rewarded too, that's a huge step. Because people want to work on great ideas with people they like. So.
And just to build on that, whenever you listen to entrepreneurs who have been successful and some hugely successful in their businesses, one of the things they will tell you is, I became successful because I surrounded myself with people that were a lot smarter than I was and knew a lot more about this than I did. Yeah.
100%. Yeah. You should be the, you should feel like you're like the dumbest person in the room. And that always is like the mentality.
Jessica?
Yes. So I want to keep building on this. Lavi made a comment about, you know, corporate helped him figure out things like building relationships and who to keep in the loop when. Rodrigo asked a question. Let's say you have an innovative idea or an invention for a product or service. Who would each of you go to first to develop this idea and start the business? Would it be a financial advisor? Would it be other startups? Like, who's go-to kind of to keep in your network? And maybe Jade. If you don't, sorry, Bernie, I'm going to direct it to Jade.
No, I'd love
to.
It's so good.
Okay.
Yeah, sure. So, Rodrigo, I left a couple of resources in the chat, but I would say before, you know, setting up a bank account and before making sure everything is official, just test the idea. Talk to about 100 people and just survey them with open-ended questions through the process of customer discovery, learning how they're currently approaching this problem and, again, learning about their pain points. You don't even have to tell them what you're building until the end of the interview, but just asking them open-ended questions can really help you validate the idea and make sure you're on the right path. After you have a pretty solid idea, I would say either build out a business model canvas or a pitch deck. Again, these are things that you can do on your own to make sure that you're really ready with your idea. Through that process, you're going to start getting excited about the idea and understanding where to go next with the process. And I left some resources for both of those in the chat.
And just to add to this from another accelerator, one of the most important functions an accelerator has is to help entrepreneurs to fail early so that you don't chase something down the road that only 2 years or 3 years later you find out you should never have tried this in the first place. It was obvious. But to force, so to say, entrepreneurs to do what Jay just said, go out, determine the customer discovery, right? Try it out here. And try, there's a whole science around this, to do this customer discovery in a way that you're not biased, you're not asking biased question, and you have those conversations with family members or potential customers that, as Jade was mentioning, with a very open mind and really listening, what are they really saying? Are they just saying they like it because they like me? That's extremely important. And it's, I find, for your accelerator side, very helpful to help these entrepreneurs fail early and then do that famous pivoting left and right and up and down and finding that spot where ultimately, you may ultimately end up in a quite a different place than where you started out with your idea of what you're going to make and sell.
That is a big difference between an entrepreneurial mindset and kind of a corporate mindset. And there's some big companies that try to adopt the same entrepreneurial approach, but sort of celebrating failure because you've learned something and it's going to help you get closer to the answer instead of being very risk averse and feeling that, you know, a failure is negative, right? It often is getting you closer to where you need to be, and it's a positive, you know.
One thing I'll say too, I think Jay's spot on in trying to validate and talk to people unbiasedly, but you can also look at data. Like, data doesn't lie. And there's a lot of different ways to find different ideas. An example is the reason I springboarded into selling tennis gear is because I just scraped a bunch of data on Amazon, and you can find software that does that. It essentially tells you what people are searching for on Amazon, and what they're buying and what niches. And how many competitors there are. So there was this like little niche of tennis dampeners. I don't know if people play tennis here, but it's like a little rubber thing you put on a tennis racket. But there were a lot of sales happening. There's one guy just raking it in, and with not a great product. And just because that one single data point led me to kind of be like, okay, there's a gap here, there's an opening. And that would, that drove all the revenue to fund the entire company going forward. So,
yeah. So I can't resist this, but this is a neat loop back to economics. I mean, Andrew, data analysis, data collection, finding patterns in data. Oh, did any of your training as an economist help you with that aspect of entrepreneurship?
You know, because the fact that, you know, careers are so strange, and I ended up at IBM, and then I got an MBA, and then I was a consultant, like Lavi was for a while, and then spoke at a conference and got hired by the conference to run all the content and became an events guy, right? So careers can take journeys like that, that you don't expect. And I'm not actively using specific things about my economics degree, but I'm using the mindset and the sort of the way that it taught me to think probably every day, right? So it's more about kind of how it trains you to think about problems and how you, the skills that you gain that are sort of problem solving skills from college. And it was really good for that. It was good for thinking about things like, okay, why was my professor saying there's no such thing as a free lunch? Well, there's a meaning behind that that I can use to think strategically about this business situation, or behavioral economics and understanding the science of how people make decisions. There may be some reason why they're buying the tennis dampeners on Amazon, right? That rather than something else because of a behavioral thing, it may not even be about the product. It could be just the user interface or something else, right? So I think it's more teaching you how to think, not so much the deep data analytics, because I'm not doing that as much. Yeah. In my career. Yeah.
Jessica, back to you. Do you have some
follow-up? There's so many. I'm trying to take them in the order they come because there's so many for grouping. But I'm going to do a compound question, and they're not necessarily the same question. They're just two, and I'll let you choose which one you want to answer. But what does your day-to-day look like as an entrepreneur or as an accelerator working with entrepreneurs? And also, if you have an interest in many fields, how do you put some things aside and figure out how to focus on one goal and specialize? Like, how have you managed that? Those that have an entrepreneurial mindset probably have a lot of things that are kind of come bubbling up. How do you focus and get down to business? So pick and choose, but those are the questions. And where do you want to start, Bernie?
Jade.
Absolutely. And I'm happy to dive in on the second question. And I saw Zeke ZYC, I'm sorry, asked this in the chat. I'm excited to answer this because this was me. So I was a student that had a lot of interest, even though I was an education major. I was constantly going to different events on campuses and traveling between different clubs to just really be able to learn from different speakers. And so I knew that I had a lot of interest and I wasn't sure where I wanted to start my career. And so what I did, very similarly to what I encourage entrepreneurs to do, was start testing. So I started meeting with different people in fields that I thought I might enjoy. And I met with them for coffee chats virtually to learn more about what their day-to-day was. I also did internships. So I also interned with early stage startups, with two during my collegiate career. And I was able to find what my sweet spot was. Both of the startups were pretty small. And so I learned that I kind of liked larger startups. I also did an internship in big tech, and I found out that was way too big for me. So just by testing it out, meeting with people, asking questions, doing internships while you can, is a great way to find out what you like or what you don't like. And it's really exciting when you find out what you don't like, because that means you're one step closer to really finding your sweet spot.
Lavi, what about your day as an entrepreneur?
Yeah, day to day. Let's see. In detail here. I mean, I generally wake up at like 5:30.
You don't need to know everything about your day.
I get woken up abruptly by my kids, I'll put it that way. And then that kicks off the morning. But work-wise, I generally like to look at dashboards and kind of what some core metrics are. Just any KPI, so key performance indicators about the business, you know, where sales are, what sales were yesterday, anything that changed year over year. Things like that. I often have, there's a bunch of meetings. I try to have the practice. I think this is a great practice that you should do, is try to talk to a customer, two or three customers at least once a week or so, you know. If you have to have a pulse, like you'll always look at high level numbers and things, but you need to have a pulse on who you're actually selling your products and services to. And my days are weird because we work a lot with Vietnam and China. So a lot of times I have calls at night, like around 10, 11 o'clock at night. So it's around the clock. I think entrepreneurial days are different to corporate because it's kind of, if I want to go watch a movie at 2 p.m. in the afternoon, I just go watch a movie at 2 p.m. afternoon. But I know that at 10 o'clock at night, I have this call. So it's just a bit more flexible. So if you kind of like that, it's a little bit less structure. If you kind of like less structure, I think entrepreneurial, that world is good for you.
So Andrew, Maya, I can throw this to you. You've got to be careful how to word this. But what then if the day is so up and down, the week's worse, right? So many stories when you hear about successful entrepreneurs that were inches from the cliff and everything's just falling down and dedicating themselves to this. What's, not to discourage our students here to maybe look at entrepreneurship as something they like, but what's sort of a psychological makeup of an entrepreneur? What do you need internally to deal with that unstructured day?
Well, we talked about, you know, being able to fail and not have it kind of crush you. And that's hard, right, for anyone, no matter what your makeup. You know, people react to things not going the way they wanted them to. So you do have to sort of, you know, build the ability to push through that. And I was hearing Lavi talk about his day. And you need to have some discipline, right? Because you can let work consume you when you're an entrepreneur. And you have to be able to take care of yourself and figure out how to set some boundaries. And you could easily work, you know, it's hard to eat and sleep, right? You could skip sleep and still be working, right? So that's important because you've got so much flexibility, which is a positive, but you have to have some discipline about your time and be able to save time for yourself, save time for your family and friends, and then be smart with the time you have and that you use for your business. And know how to prioritize, know how to say no. Don't let, you know, other people kind of dictate what your priorities are, that you need to dictate what your priorities are. And so because it's unstructured, you have to be able to provide that structure to be successful. And it's something you have to learn. It's a privilege. And I personally like it a lot. I'd much rather, you know, provide my own structure than have, you know, someone do it for me. But it, you know, you do have to have the ability to do that on your own.
Yeah. Jessica.
Yes. So the next question, I skipped over one. Someone asked, what are some really good books that, you know, you could prefer? And I think Jade shared some in the chat, and I think Lavi mentioned one, but I want to invite all the panelists. I think links are helpful. So if you have like books you'd recommend, maybe drop those in the chat so that folks can have a direct link to them. So I'm going to skip that one unless, does anyone want to talk to that question about a book that was really impactful? If not, there's several other questions. So we can keep the conversation going. No one's coming off
you. In case you missed it, I thought Jade's message is really good about podcasts. Like I don't have time that much time to read anymore, and podcasts are super effective in getting important points across.
Thanks, Lavi, and thanks, Jade.
I can jump on with something here, just aside, I sign up to several blogs that are about good news. What cheered me up today? And I love to, so with all the bad news around us, I love to start the day with some good news. Somebody did something over there, somebody did over here. It's just a great way to start your day and not feel too much knocked down by all the stuff that happens around us.
So the next question that came up, I'm going to go to Mario. So he asked about legal advice. And I know Lavi and I think Jade shared some resources, but his question was, when starting a company and talking to people to join, how do you decide the percentage share of ownership so that the incentive to work hard is enough? So can you talk to us a little bit about maybe co-founders and bringing people in?
Sinead, you want to dive on first?
I would throw it to Lavi, actually. I would love to hear more from someone that had experience potentially working with co-founders or not.
I guess a couple of like thoughts I had. I think like you should never be stingy on equity. Like it, if the person, you know, it can be really helpful and drive the company forward. You'd rather have a smaller slice of something big as opposed to all of a slice of nothing. So knowing that, like me and my founder, we split it, I think, because it was originally my initial concept, and there was a lot of time spent initially before that person came on. So because of that, it wasn't exactly a 50-50, but it was close to it, right? So I think there's a lot of nuance and a lot of just different considerations to take into account. So it's hard to give a cut and dry. I know there's a lot of good resources and kind of the benchmarks and things you can follow. I don't have any of those links on hand right now, but yeah, not the best answer, but I think it's a lot of things to consider. You don't want to do it lightly. Something to think over for sure.
I guess, Lavi, it depends a lot on how much capital, how much money you need to execute your idea, right? So if it's an idea that requires you to raise, you know, millions of dollars, that's a different dynamic than something you can sort of bootstrap and do with less capital. Because unless you happen to have the capital yourself to fund it, you may have to give away some equity in order to get the resources you need to build your business. Yeah.
If I can add two aspects to that, probably on top of it, more so than how much equity to give away, you need to be very, very intentional about who you're taking equity from. Because these are not just money givers to your company, they're partners. And they will have a say. Your term papers will allow them some say. And if you only find out 2 years down the road that you're really not aligned with one of your investors, you have a totally different view about what long-term this company should do, that's not good. You want to be very, very specific, and you want to know what kind of person with what kind of a purpose for that business you take money from. You also need to know what your goals are, because if you want to build your company long and very long-term to do something good in the world, for example, you got to be very careful with giving equity away, because so many entrepreneurs against their will have lost their company because they lost control. It can happen. But if you're more short-term oriented and you're looking at a quick exit out of something big, that might be less of an issue for you.
Bernie, there's a handful more questions and we're nearing the top of our allotted time. So can I pull one out? I had one myself, and it's about mentorship. So we talked about accelerators, we talked about community, but as my tennis coach, Lavi, I know you've interfaced with a few folks in a mentorship kind of relationship to learn some tricks and trades. And I just wonder if maybe each of our entrepreneurs, including you, Jade, from when you were kind of starting your business, if you could talk about the importance of mentorship and what you learned from that, or how you picked that person.
Yeah. So I think I had two that I'll call out. One was someone I met on a Facebook group, oddly enough, just on e-commerce selling platform. We hit it off. My parents are Cambodian. He was living in Cambodia. It was super random. But we started talking, and it was really good. I mean, it was mutually beneficial relationship, but he was a bit more experienced. So I learned a lot. But over as time progressed, like, you know, I build a network, he does, and we just share it. So it's a very good relationship. Another one is one of the kids I coached tennis, his dad was he worked at Atlanta Tech Community, ATC in Atlanta, and that's what he does. He just loves to mentor. He's going to do like a consulting thing, but we hit it off and he just helped. And I think the benefits there is you just have someone to talk to, someone to bounce ideas off. They may not give you the right answers all the time, but it's someone to really kind of share ideas and things with. But then, and a lot of times they do it because they just want to help. And the idea is that when you have the chance to help someone else, you do the same. So it's kind of that kind of give and take, pay it forward.
Jade, anything to that?
Yeah, I would definitely say utilize your status as a student. So, you know, the reality is a lot of professionals, a lot of entrepreneurs, everyone that's reaching out are also professionals. It's rare that a student reaches out for mentorship. So when I was a student entrepreneur, our team really hit the ground running, and we just reached out to any and everyone for help, for guidance. And we were really successful in hearing back because we were students and there were so many entrepreneurs and people in the ecosystem that wanted to give back. And I've been able to stay connected with a lot of those people to this day. And it's been really rewarding. So I say, you know, use your student status, start, you know, reaching out to any and everyone, even, you know, on LinkedIn, just go ahead and take that leap. You'll find that a lot of people will want to help you just because you're a student. And I'll also add, you know, there was a lot of conversation about whether to take that leap as an entrepreneur post-grad. I say go ahead and do it while you're an undergrad as well. You know, you have the safety net of school that's built there. You're going to continue to be a student. You're working towards a degree. So go after your dreams and build out those bold ideas and see what happens. You know, you've got a built-in backup plan at this time. So go ahead and chase those dreams.
Quick thing on mentorship. So mentors come in a lot of different shapes and sizes. And some of my mentors have been someone that I encountered in my life and my professional career that were really good at something that I wanted to become better at. Like, for example, selling. So I had a consulting friend who was someone that we worked at the same consulting firm. He was really good at selling new consulting projects. And so don't be afraid to just sort of build those relationships and ask people, you know, how do you do that? what makes you so good at this? You know, what book did you read? And it might just be, they don't have to be a mentor that's going to mentor every aspect of your career or your life, but there may just be people that you can learn from along the way in one specific area. Yeah.
I'd like to hear from you. Sort of looping back to economists and economics, you mentioned some things that were helpful. Just out of curiosity, did you find in your life then as an entrepreneur and building businesses, did you find that some concepts you learned about in college as an economist student just didn't turn out that way in real life?
You know, you warned me you were going to ask me this question, and I still don't have a great answer, Bernie. I think most of the things that I picked out of being an economics major held true, because if I was focused on the notion that it's people making decisions, some big picture dynamics around supply and demand, that hold true in the marketplace. Some things you learn in sort of like game theory that are really helpful as an economics major when you're thinking about strategies. I think most of it, nothing was disproven. I think there are a lot of things I kind of forgotten about, just like any other subject you have in school that you don't apply every day. But no, I don't think any of it was bunk.
Okay. Yeah. Bernie, can I pile on there? And I want to give a shout out to Kayla's question. She asks, in your experience, what would you specify as the biggest behavioral challenge that you've seen from buyers in the market since COVID? But I think, again, Bernie, pulling back in this theme about economics, like thinking about shocks and what that does to pricing, what that does to employment levels and hiring, what that does to supply chains, I think is huge. And so I wonder if from any of those perspectives, I know, Andrew, yours is more of a service, yeah, right? Like rather than a product. I know, Lavi, you have a product, you source things. Like, can you speak to any of those dynamics and how you think about that and how economics might be helpful in thinking through those things as a business owner?
Yeah, I mean, the macro effect of COVID for tennis was actually one of the more less contact sports. So it actually thrived in COVID. And I know a lot of other sports like basketball declined quite a bit. So that actually was very, very positively impacting our company. On the supply chain side, yeah, it wreaked havoc. Like we estimated, our estimates for shipping costs and duties and things like that went up almost 10x on things. So it's just like, I don't know all the right economic words, but I know that there's a lot of things in play and it impacted our business quite a bit. But yeah, you can't like really sulk over any of the issues. You have to figure out how to get by it and learn from it. So.
Jade or Andrew?
I just dropped another book recommendation in the chat of Freakonomics. So it's really interesting. It's written by an economist and it's sort of like the law of unintended consequences that sometimes, you know, a decision that's made to cause one thing to happen causes a bunch of other things you didn't anticipate to happen. And it's a very interesting thing to read and it makes you think very differently about the world. So go back to your question about economics. That would be a fun one for people to read. Yeah.
Since we're getting close to the top here to the end of our allotted time, just very quickly, I wanted to give every one of you the opportunity to just say, out of all the things we touched on in this hour, is there anything you would like to leave the students with from your wisdom from your life so far? You want to start with that, Lavi?
Yeah, I think one of the key traits of a good entrepreneur, I think, is grit. Getting up after you fall, because you will fall and you will fail. It just I haven't spoke to any successful entrepreneur who hasn't failed. You'll get bruises and things, yeah, just come back up. And always be willing to learn. I think Andrew mentioned like learning how to learn is key, and that's, I can't emphasize that enough. Like there are so many resources to learn. Like school is one of them, YouTube, like anywhere, Facebook groups, surprisingly, it's just a gem for e-commerce. So things like that. So I'll leave it at that. I'll pass it to you, Jade.
Absolutely. Well, I've really enjoyed speaking with everyone today. And I would just add to that, you know, go ahead and take that leap. Why not? You will absolutely fail. But it's important to fail fast. And there's so many great learnings on the entrepreneurial journey. You'll meet a lot of great people. And it's just a cool way to get started on developing your idea. In the chat, I'll share my Twitter. I like to share resources for entrepreneurs there. So feel free to connect with me there afterwards. And then if there's any HBCU student or alumni entrepreneurs on here today, make sure you check out the HBCU Founders Initiative. We have a lot of great resources. Thanks.
Andrew, you got the last word.
Oh, wow. So I think Jade made a great point about using your position as a student to try things and experiment. It's a great safe time of your life. It's much more difficult if you have a family and a house and, you know, kids and to do those kind of things. So it's great to do it when you're young. And your career will take off, you know, many people's careers, takes a lot of twists and turns, right, to get you. So, and along the way, it's good to have a passion and be really laser focused to try to make that happen, but balance it with being open-minded and being able to pivot and to do something different. Or maybe the way you thought it was going to happen isn't going to happen, but something slightly different could be even better. And being open to that, I think, is really important. I think a lot of people get locked in and get really try to bang their head against the wall rather than being open to pivoting and adjusting your idea and making it go. But it's great to have the opportunity to talk to a group of students and hope it was helpful.
Great. Thank you very much. Thanks to all three of you. It was a great conversation. Jessica, any closing words?
This was a treasure trove of information. So thank you all so much for taking time out in the evening to talk with us. And students, thank you so much for taking time out to join the conversation. And Kelsey, thank you for joining from Invest Atlanta. Kelsey works a lot with entrepreneurs, and I think she and Invest are a local resource. And so she shared her contact information. Jade, Lavi, Andrew, have you dropped yours in the chat? Would you mind sharing?
No, I will. I'll do it now.
Yeah.
Okay, that sounds good. Yeah. So I think all of our expert entrepreneurs are open and willing to chat with you if you want to follow up after the event. So thanks everyone. And we have our next event for students on September 26th. We're going to talk about, I open this up so I would know. We will be talking about creating your pathway in economics. And so Georgia Tech's Econ Club is hosting this event on September 26th. And Asalia, do you know the time? Can you remind me? Is it at 6 p.m.?
6 p.m.
6 p.m. September 26th. So mark your calendars and we'll make sure for everyone that signed in, we'll send out a reminder for that event. So thanks, everyone. We'll see you soon.